They've started. You're looking right now live at the Mueller hearings. Joining us, Judge Andrew Napolitano and Liz Peek, and David Barnson will chime in as well. I'm not sure whether we can get him on camera. Yes, we got him on camera. David Barnson, you handle the financial side of this. I don't think that these hearings will have any impact on Wall Street whatsoever. What say you?
Not only are you right, that has been the case since the special counsel was appointed in the spring of 2017. We're now over 2 years of the market not caring about all of the ebbs and flows of this report as the thing peters out and eventually gets left on the ash heap of news drama. The market does not care. They care about earnings. They care about the Fed. They care about the economy. They don't care about this distraction.
What was that expression? The ash heap of what?
News drama. This is this whole thing right now, and it is drama that is not in the Democrats' favor.
So I'm going to steal that line.
You're welcome.
I'm going to ask the same questions I asked a half an hour ago. Having seen an hour's worth of testimony at the Mueller hearings, do you think it will have any direct and immediate impact on the stock market?
I do not. And if I did believe there was going to be any impact, it would be positive. And this is sort of a stretch. I think the market would prefer that President Trump be reelected to one of the Democratic candidates that's on kind of the far left right now. And I think that if anything, this hearing is likely to help boost President Trump's reelection prospects. So if there's any market impact that I would try to connect dots on, that would be it. Here today, again, as the judge said earlier, short of a rabbit being pulled out of a hat, this to me looks like a non-event in the markets.
All right, let's get to pure money, shall we? This is a very big week for big tech. Let's check those stocks. We check them all the time. You have to, because that's where the money is. The Justice Department is opening a broad antitrust review of the big tech companies. Now, I'm questioning whether or not the big techs should be worried about this. That being the case, Susan, of those stocks on the screen right now, the greatest liability is with Amazon, Facebook, and Google.
Correct.
They're the ones under the greatest scrutiny, it would seem to me, as opposed to Apple and certainly not Microsoft. I don't think Microsoft features in this, does it?
Not especially, but I really think that the other reason... That
I hope not. You're laughing because I got a little bit of Microsoft. Go on.
And you love Microsoft, and it's great.
But the other reason Apple and Microsoft are not necessarily as connected to the problems here is that their PEs are somewhat reasonable. See, the problem you have is that this can go on for a long time, and it compresses valuation, and you have a very expensive valuation with at least Facebook, Amazon, and Google.
Right. Look, the stock is at $202 a share as we speak, despite the fine, Zuckerberg, the privacy issues, all the rest of it, all the terrible PR, $202 a share. You know why? Because when they report, I think it's in the next 24 hours.
After the bell, yes.
If they make serious money, like they usually make serious money. That's what the market, that's what investors
look at. But it was 230 a year ago, Stuart. It's down 15% in a period that the market is up 15%. So 200 is a big share and 800 billion is a big market cap, but it's down substantially relative to the whole rest of the world over the last year.
AT&T, their profit down, not much, but down on the Time Warner merger cost. The stock actually is up 2.25%. I bought that on your recommendation, by the way, because it yields 6%.
We talked about this last time. It was Verizon that we are recommending. We sold out of AT&T. This is a totally different company. We had owned AT&T a long time. We sold it over a year ago. AT&T is a very leveraged company now. There's
it's
lot of
debt. It's the most indebted in the world.
Most indebted company in the world. It's more indebted than most countries are.
Well, also,
but it pays a 6% dividend.
It does. And remember that that hold up with CBS, and it went dark basically at 2 a.m. on Monday. But apparently they've negotiated a deal, and CBS is back on Dish for those Dish subscribers.
That's right. By the way, David, Verizon yields 4%.
Ooh.
About 4.8.
But I bought AT&T.
Yes.
6.2.
Right. But Verizon has 50% better coverage than AT&T, so we shall continue the conversation.
Dunkin' will start offering Beyond Meat breakfast sausage. Now, we cover this at the top of the show. I don't want to be too repetitive, but David, who is sitting next to me, wouldn't touch Beyond Meat with a 10-foot pole, would you?
No, and again, there's a better likelihood that I'll buy their shares than I'll buy their product.
Really?
I'm just a real big
meat eater. What's wrong with you? You are?
I love steak. I love the real thing. And I think that's sort of obvious as you sit and look at me that I probably eat a little too much regular meat. But I appreciate you not making any jokes about it. But I would love to see Beyond Meat be a successful company. They already are an incredibly successful enterprise. This is a classic case of a disconnect between a company and a stock. They've gotten equity financing. It's very cheap capital, and they're going to use it to grow, and they're going to continue to grow. The problem is they're starting from such a low denominator of a base and have already priced in a $12 billion market cap. Come up with any number you want of earnings. The fact right now that they're going to lose about $100 million on the year. Assume into the future they're making $500 million, which would take them 100 years at this rate of growth to get there. They're not going to be able to justify this market capitalization.
What you're paying for with Beyond Meat, it's up close to 200% since its IPO price, is that you're paying for their market share of a growing industry.
That's exactly right. Yeah, and they're a first to market.
First mover. So it's expected to expand the meatless market to $140 billion over 10 years. Given that they oversee a big chunk of that right now, you're paying for growth.
It's a concept stock.
It's like Tesla. Yeah. I mean, Tesla has more probably legitimacy than this, but it's, you know, same.
But I think to Stuart's question, why we wouldn't buy it, it is not that I don't think the stock can go higher. I just think people have to understand they're taking on unbelievable risk in buying something like this. It's highly speculative. That's all.
All right. Beyond Meat has just dropped 1 cent below $200 a share. You did it. You did that.
My fault.
You did that.